We've got quite a few projects underneath us, and ASLR is one of the projects that we took on. And while people are joining in, while people are still filing in, I thought I would have a little egotistical moment and talk a little bit about me. I'm a big fan of open source. When I started learning how to program when I was like 12 or so, I didn't even have a computer. I wrote in C on like a piece of paper or anything. It really sucked. And so did my code. But I'm a big fan of open source. When we got a computer and I finally got online, I would look at other people's source code and learn from others. That was a big help. I love FreeBSD and ZFS. Great technologies in FreeBSD. ZFS is amazing. I'm such a fanboy of ZFS that I even have it running on my little netbook, which kind of sucks, makes it a little bit slow, but it works. I'm passionate about security. The first time I got online, I was like 14, and I spent a whole month convincing my parents that we need a 56K dial-up modem. And we got online using the free trial of AOL, and then I found out about Net Zero and Juno. And so Net Zero and Juno, they provide free dial-up service, or they did at the time, but they made it so that you had to install adware on your system. So it would be a program that it displays just a little rectangular image with ads. I'm like, dude, this takes up a lot of my precious dial-up bandwidth. I can't deal with this. And so my first experience with security was downloading a hex editor and looking at how the strings and stuff, how the dial-up program authenticated and grepping through using strings to look at all the 800 dial-up numbers. So we didn't have to call long distance either. And so I found out how what numbers it uses and how it authenticates with their servers, and I ended up scripting my own little dial-up connection client so that I wouldn't have to use their adware. So that was pretty fun. I've submitted a few patches to FreeBSD. By far, ASLR is the biggest. I'm a maintainer of a few FreeBSD ports. Mainly dealing with jails and Go and Drupal. I'm the author of LibHijack.
Dude, I remember you.
That's not necessarily a good thing.
I spoke last year about it. It's a tool that makes a shared library that makes runtime process infection easy on Linux and FreeBSD. It's a pretty cool tool. You can inject shell code in as little as 8 lines of C code. It's pretty nifty. One of my friends right now is porting it to ARM for Linux. So eventually, hopefully, we'll use LibHijack for a lot of security things on Android devices. A little bit of a disclaimer. Of course, I have to put this to satisfy the legal department. Any opinions, thoughts, ideas, tools, blah, 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 they reflect me only and Soldier X, not any of my previous employers, my current employers, or future employers. So I'm here on my own accord. I am representing Soldier X here today because they've donated hardware to the project, they've donated resources. They're pretty cool peeps. So what we're going to do is we're going to start off with a few definitions. We're going to start off, you know, try to get on the same page with what ASLR is and the history behind it. Then we're going to talk about FreeBSD security strengths and their weaknesses, some of the things that need to be improved upon. And then we're going to talk about what we can learn from others, because FreeBSD is pretty much the last enterprise operating system to implement ASLR. And so we have the unique opportunity to learn from the strengths and mistakes of others. Then I'm going to talk about how we've implemented ASLR in a very kind of high-level detail, because I've only got 45 minutes, And ASLRs, their ASLR touches quite a few different places in the system, in the source code. I don't have the time to go in depth, but I'm at least going to show you the files that are modified and what we do. Then I'm going to talk about how to use ASLR in FreeBSD and what needs to happen next. Then I've got a live demo, and I did sacrifice 3.5 goats to the demo gods.
Hooray.
And the goat BOF was born. So for definitions, security, it's what Sony and Mt. Gox have in common. They suck at it. Really, security is just an onion that's made up of ever-increasing layers. And the more layers you have, the more time and resources it's going to take an attacker to successfully exploit your system. So we have many different layers, and one of those layers are different exploit mitigation techniques. And an exploit mitigation technique is a method or technique to prevent the successful exploitation of security vulnerabilities. Our computers have millions and millions and millions of lines of code in them. You know, all these programs, tens of, dozens of programs, hundreds of programs we run on our computer, and we don't know where the vulnerabilities lie. But an attacker, a dedicated attacker, is going to use whatever means possible to pop a shell on your box. And so exploit mitigation technologies allow you to secure your system from the unknown, at least help in giving you more time to be able to address security vulnerabilities. ASLR is one such exploit mitigation technology. It is address-based layout randomization. So what happens is, without ASLR, your application that you want to run, like Firefox, for example, says to the operating system, I expect to be loaded at this address. My data is here. I need it here. If it's not here, I'm going to crash. And so, so your program is loaded in a deterministic way. So if there's a vulnerable function, if there's a piece of data that an attacker is interested in, either a vulnerable function or a password stored in memory, a social security number, credit card number, whatever it is, then the attacker knows exactly how to reach that point in memory and trigger that vulnerability. What ASLR does is it randomizes where the program and its dependencies are loaded in memory. So the attacker doesn't know, the attacker knows that there is a vulnerability, but he doesn't know where in memory it is. So the program, like Firefox, I was saying, for example, will tell the operating system, hey, I can be loaded anywhere in memory. That's fine. My data can be loaded anywhere in memory. I'll make do. You just tell me where I'm loaded, and we'll make amends. So ASLR helps protect against very low-level attacks, buffer overflows, return to libc, and when you mix that with like full format string vulnerabilities and integer overflows, you know, really low-level things. ASLR doesn't help protect against PHP, LFI, and RFI, and SQL injection attacks, and cross-site scripting, all that fun stuff. You know, that's too high level for ASLR. So we're really just talking about really low-level vulnerabilities here. You can think of exploits like Stuxnet and Flame and even Heartbleed, even though ASLR wouldn't have helped in the Heartbleed case, but same kind of low-level type of thing. To give a little bit of history, this is all on Wikipedia, so thanks, Wikipedia University. Just to get on the same page, though, in 2001, we now know that the PAX team is just a single person, but at the time, we didn't know if it was one person or multiple people. So I still call them the PAX team just because that's how we've called them over the years. They implemented, as a third-party patch, ASLR for Linux. And And in 2004, OpenBSD picked up that patch, and it took
didn't know about it.
Oh, you didn't?
It wasn't intended.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Well, then I was wrong. Well, in 2004, OpenBSD started implementing ASLR. I guess maybe not based on packs, but at least their current implementation is based on packs, I believe. No?
No, it's completely independent.
Really? Okay. All right.
It may have been based on the same research.
Okay. But not on...
None of the code.
None of the code.
None of the code. I don't think of any of their papers.
Okay. All right. Well, I learned something new every day. So it took OpenBSD 4 years to implement ASLR, but to their credit, they had a lot more work to do. They had to change a whole lot of stuff in order to support ASLR. Because we're coming at this a little bit behind, we don't have to change as much stuff. There's not a lot, not as many prerequisites for implementing ASLR. For us, it's already been done. In 2005, Linux ripped PAX's ASLR, and they dumbed it down, called it more secure, and did a lot of politics bullcrap there. I'll talk a bit about more about Linux in our learning from others slide. In 2007, Microsoft introduced ASLR into Windows Vista. Their initial ASLR implementation was crap. Very easy to bypass, extremely easy. It was pretty much useless. They made some design and architecture decisions that were more of a mistake that last till today, because they had to add some fields to the PE header to say, we'll talk about that later. But yeah, they introduced ASLR in 2007. It took Apple 5 years to finish up their ASLR work for OS X, which they started in 2007. In 2011, Sun or Oracle, I don't remember what year Oracle bought Sun, but they introduced ASLR into Solaris 11. In 2014, Oliver Pinter and I submitted call for testing emails to the mailing list for our ASLR implementation on FreeBSD. And FreeBSD has a lot of security strengths. FreeBSD security mainly relies on policy-based security decisions. The MAC framework, NFSv4 and POSIX-ACL, secure level, auditisty, and jails. And you can think of jails and Beehive as sort of a policy-based security, because you're saying that I don't trust this application, so I'm going to jail it. FreeBSD has kind of a hybrid policy-based and exploit mitigation technology, sandboxing, known as Capsicum. That's a pretty good implementation. Sandboxing is pretty cool. So I don't have that listed on the slide. I forgot to put it, but Capsicum seems to be pretty useful, pretty promising for the future. Non-technology or non-policy technology, so these are exploit mitigation technologies, non-exec stack for AMD 64, and ptrace restrictions. Fun little fact is the ptrace restriction prevents libhijack from working. So FreeBSD does have a few weaknesses. There were the non-exec stack. That means that you can put your shellcode on the stack. You can, when you're exploiting an application, your end goal is to run arbitrary code known as shellcode. But you can store it on the stack. You're just not going to get it to run on the stack. And FreeBSD has that, but it doesn't. It's not working on all platforms. I have a Raspberry Pi, and supposedly it supports a non-exec stack, but it doesn't. So once we're finished with the ASLR patch itself, I'm going to go back and take a look and see why non-exec stack isn't being obeyed on ARM. And so One of the things that goes hand in hand with ASLR is called position independent executable support. And I'm going to call that PI because that's a lot easier to say than position independent executable. So ASLR, really, to be effective, needs PI support. So that's the part that tells the operating system, hey, I can, that the program can be loaded anywhere in memory. And so for ASLR to be effective, PI support needs to happen in base. And I'm actually working on that right now and hoping to get a patch up to Brian Drury tonight to be merged into head. So that'll be coming here soon. Of course, there's no ASLR in FreeBSD. That's why we're talking about it. And grsec is a third-party patch to the Linux kernel that hardens the kernel and the user land. My end goal is to port all the features that make sense for FreeBSD to FreeBSD. So to learn from others, Linux is really political. It's a territorial pissing contest when it comes to this kind of stuff. What they did was they saw Pax's work, but they didn't want an implementation from an anonymous author. We didn't know, the Linux guys didn't know who wrote Pax's ASLR implementation. And so they wanted something of their own, and instead of trying to figure out who it was and contact them, you know, there's an actual email address for them. They could have just emailed the guy. They ripped Pax's code and dumbed it down and called it more secure. And the one thing that drives me to FreeBSD more than anything, I love FreeBSD's technologies. The one thing that drives me to FreeBSD over everything is the lack of politics. when it comes to this kind of stuff. I sat down with Des the other day, and I was kind of scared because this is the first time that I ever had a major patch review, and I was kind of scared. And it was more about the technology. You know, he had some ideas and suggestions, and it's more like, you've got a patch, that's cool. We need to get this in. But first, let's fix a few issues. You know, it's more about the technology with FreeBSD than the territorial pissing contest. And that's been my experience. You know, other people's experience may vary, but that's been my experience when submitting patches and helping out the FreeBSD project. It's not nearly as mind-numbing as it is with Linux. And so, technologically speaking, Linux's ASLR, so I'm not going to talk about Pax, because Linux's actual ASLR implementation is pretty weak and pretty dumb. It's either turn ASLR on globally or turn it off globally. So if you want ASLR, if you want this exploit mitigation technology on your system, but you have one application that is closed source, you know, kind of like Flash or the NVIDIA binaries, that kind of thing.
The ones you want to have ASLR for.
Yes. If an application that is misbehaving under ASLR, like it's crashing or there's other bugs, then you have to have ASLR turned off for the whole system. So that's stupid. So the two things that I took away from this is that we need to randomize enough bits, because that's the problem with Linux's ASLR. That's one of the problems with Linux's ASLR, is that they're not randomizing enough bits. And there's no way to control how many bits you want to randomize. So, and there's no way to toggle it on a per application basis. That's kind of a half lie, but not really. This command up there, that set arch right there, you have to use that command every single time you run this application that you want ASLR disabled for. And it's kind of stupid. So if you have like an application that gets started via init scripts, you have to go and modify init scripts to disable ASLR. So every time you update the package for that, you have to back out your modifications, let the package update, and then reinsert your modifications. It's stupid. So one of the things that I learned from Linux is we want to be more flexible, more dynamic than that. Windows, now with Windows 7, Windows 8, they have a pretty decent technical implementation. The biggest issue there is individual DLLs and EXEs can have ASLR turned on or off. So in EXE, both EXEs and DLLs are just PE files. And there is a bit inside of the PE file that says, for this object, ASLR is turned on or off. And so you can have an EXE that depends on, let's say, five DLLs, for example. We'll say the EXE has ASLR turned off and four or turned on, and four out of the five DLLs have ASLR turned on. So that means one DLL has ASLR turned off. So the ASLR will get applied, the Windows will apply ASLR to the EXE and to the four DLLs, and ASLR won't get applied to the one DLL. So we'll be kind of in this hybrid state where ASLR was kind of applied, but kind of not. And that is a big issue because, for example, just recently, I can't name the vendor, but there was one vendor who, if you use Windows, you probably use their software every day or nearly every day, especially if you're looking at documentation. They had just released a new version of their software, and it depended on quite a few different DLLs. And it was just that exact same scenario. They had compiled their applications with ASLR support and all the DLLs except for one. There was a vulnerability in one of the DLLs that had ASLR turned on, but the call stack was such that the control flow could be controlled via the DLL that had ASLR turned off. And because they could use that DLL that had ASLR turned off, because that was loaded in a deterministic way, their attackers were able to successfully exploit the application using nothing more than just your standard exploitation techniques. So that can be a major issue. We still have that kind of issue with ELF, with the ELF file format on FreeBSD, but that's because the ELF file format was designed years and years and years and years, way before ASLR was even thought of. So that's why PI support is really important, because otherwise you're not randomizing all of the address space. You're randomizing, if you don't have ASLR or PI support for that application, you're still randomizing where the dependencies, the shared objects, get loaded, but not the binary itself. So you still kind of have that DLL issue, just in reverse. So ASLR is available for FreeBSD is available on all architectures FreeBSD supports, with some, we don't have hardware for all architectures, of course, so your mileage may vary. We actively test on AMD64, i386, ARM, and kind of Spark 64. Vanilla FreeBSD, you know, just FreeBSD 11 current without the ASLR patches at all, has issues on Spark 64. So I haven't been able to test the ASLR stuff too much on Spark 64. So we have exec-based randomization via PI. I'm still working on the PI patch, and we're going to hopefully get that in base here by tonight. I ran into some issues with being able to compile the bootloader, so that's kind of important. So two of my favorite features, if an application, we're going to have three ways that you can toggle ASLR for individual binaries. One isn't implemented yet, that is FS extended attributes. So you can set an extended attribute for the binary in the FS that says, hey, don't apply ASLR when you're executing this application. Another way is to, if your application is misbehaving, you can jail that application and have ASLR turned off just for that jail. So you have ASLR turned on for your host OS and all your other jails, but for just this jail, you can have ASLR turned off. And my favorite feature overall is that I've tied into the file system firewall known as UGFW, which is part of the Mac framework, that allows you to specify dynamic rules as kind of like a IPFW style rules for controlling ASLR on a per binary and even like per user and per group basis. So it's pretty cool.
So what's the difference from Windows? Windows seems less fine grained than what you're doing.
From Windows,
wouldn't you have the same problem? That's what I'm asking. If Adobe would be installed on FreeBSD, would have a chain of SOs or whatever.
Yeah, it's kind of in Windows case, you can have an individual DLL that doesn't have ASLR turned on. And in FreeBSD's case, it would be the binary itself, not the shared object.
But the shared object is an ELF as well.
It is, but it's already, shared objects are compiled such that they're already randomizable. That's the nature of a shared object. It can be loaded anywhere in memory. And so previously, without the ASLR patches, shared objects were getting loaded in a deterministic way. They were always getting loaded at the same address. Even though they could be relocated, they weren't. So that's part of this ASLR patch is to do that for shared objects.
And it's for all objects that the binary loads would have ASLR applied or not applied, depending on your setting. Or would it be you can load a binary with ASLR turned on and some of the shared objects may have it turned on?
No.
Okay.
No. It's the reverse. Okay. Shared objects will always get randomized unless ASLR is turned off for the binary or in the jail.
Okay.
So if your binary is not compiled as a position-independent executable, though, compiling as a position-independent executable turns your executable into a shared object, pretty much. So if your executable itself is not compiled as a PI, then the executable will be loaded at a deterministic address in a deterministic way. So so we kind of have the opposite of the same type of Windows problem, but in the opposite way. So yeah. And I'll show you how that all works. Here are all the settings, all the sysctl tunables. The status tunable says there's three different values for that, integer-based. One is you have to have your applications opt in via the UGFW, or setting it to two says opt out, meaning that all applications will have ASLR applied except for the ones that you say you want to opt out of. And three means that it's enabled globally, that we're going to force ASLR to be turned on everywhere for every application. Really, my favorite feature is the UGFW integration, because you can create firewall rules that apply per user, per group, per file, or per object You can define an object as not a file, but as different ways. You can take a look at the man page for the object stuff. It's really cool. It's very powerful. But there is some ABI and KBI breakage with this. So if you are a third-party developer and you've developed based off of the libugitfw stuff, then there is a little bit of ABI breakage. You'll need to recompile your application. API, there's no API breakage, so all your function calls and stuff will remain the same, but I did have to change some underlying structures. So an example rule would be, for me, if I want to disable ASLR for this test application, then I could say, add a rule for my user only. When I run this test application, that small a means disable ASLR. So that's pretty cool.
And if a different user runs that application, they get ASLR.
Yeah. So so this is kind of low-level details, the higher-level version of the low-level details. In kernpacks.c, those are just generic helper functions. And kernpacksaslr.c is where the sysctls are implemented. And the math of how we're applying the ASLR is done. And imageac.elf is where we're doing the runtime linker randomizations. And it's where we've implemented Py support. So there is an issue, there is a potential issue with compiling as a Py. In that, since we're randomizing the load address of the executable, you might end up with a non-null address. Or, well, our implementation guarantees that you won't have a null mapping. So that's kind of important. We double checked and made sure that isn't an issue. Null mappings will never happen with our ASLR and Py implementation. So this bullet's a little out of date as of today. There's two knobs that need to be set. One is user controlled and one is developer controlled. The user controlled knob is with Py. So you put with Py in your make.conf or source.conf if you just want source.conf if you want Py only for base, make.conf if you want it globally. But some applications don't support being compiled as a Py, and some applications kind of are buggy when ran as a Py. So each application must. This is the part that's out of date. I'm turning this opt-in to opt-out. So by default, applications in base will compile as a Py, except for those that have the no Py equals yes flag. So I'm adding, what's that? Are you imp?
Yeah. let's talk about that.
Okay. There isn't really any other way. We'll talk. But I don't know if there's any other way to do it other than a no flag. So
There is now.
Cool. So I'll utilize that. Crap, I gotta go and change all like 30 different files. So
no politics, isn't it great?
Well, see, that's exactly it. They're helping me. They're like, hey, do it a different way, but they're helping me with it. Whereas with Linux it'd be like, go screw yourself. But he could, but he doesn't.
Have a nice day.
And water, have a nice day.
But the next project is going to be dealing with the ports framework after this, and that's going to be a project in and of itself. So it's a good thing that I work with some ports people just 20 feet away. Well, a little bit more than that. But that's going to be my next major project, is adding Py support to the ports framework. So how to use it? Compile your kernel with the PAX ASLR option. Right now, ASLR is not in base, so you have to apply a patch. So we're still in the call for testing phase. So apply the patch, add PAX ASLR to your kernel, recompile, install the kernel. By default, ASLR will be turned on when you compile with that kernel option. And if you use jails, child jails will inherit the parent jail settings. So that means if you have ASLR turned off for the parent, then when you boot up the new jail, ASLR will be turned off for the jail when it boots up. And if you want to take advantage of Py support, then you have to compile your applications with the dash F Py and dash Py C flags, and ideally also add dash Py to your LD flags as well. I'm going to skip this slide because our segfault protection, which is a recommended feature for ASLR but is not required, we're still working out the low-level details of that. Segfault protection is a very difficult thing to architect, and we're going between like two or three different designs and architectures for our implementation. And so we're still a little bit undecided on how we want to implement that. Basically, what segfault protection does is it frustrates the attacker that is trying to determine the inner workings of ASLR to see if there's any deterministic behavior. So like, if there's a vulnerability that the attacker is triggering that causes a segfault, and like SSHD will restart the process automatically if it crashes or if it exits. An attacker will basically do, you know, like a password brute force attack, but in this case, a segfault brute force attack. Segfault protection just adds a delay into restarting that application.
Just one thing, Linux only has segfault, but VC kernels have bus error from where pointers get corrupted as well, so make sure that that's included as well.
Okay. That's really good to know. I did not know that. Danilo Egea, who is a committer, is actually working on the segfault protection feature, and so I'll bring that up with him. So for future work, I need help with the ARM stuff. I don't know the ARM architecture very well. I attended yesterday's ARM intro presentation. That was really helpful, but I still don't know jack about ARM. So if you own a BeagleBone Black or Raspberry Pi, and are willing to test this stuff out, get with me, and I'd love some help with that. Hopefully, we're going to be committing the Py support today after I remake all my changes to not do the no Py thing. We need testing. We need people to test this. I've been running the ASLR patches on my box for pretty much since its inception, and our ASLR implementation, at least for AMD64, is solid. I have not had a single issue. I now have Chrome, the Chromium project, compiled as a Py, and it works great, except for HTML5 audio and video doesn't work anymore. I don't know why. So my end goal, though, is once ASLR is done and in base, and Py support is done and in base, and NX support is fixed on non-AMD64 and I think i386 architectures, then I'm going to work on more GRSec and PAX features. I'm probably going to work on WXORX next, and then mProtect. So Now is the demo. So you can see in this test application, basically all I'm doing is I've got a pointer that points to some data, and I'm just printing out the address of that pointer. So you can see sysctl security.pax.aslr. You can see I've got ASLR turned on. Just had a brain fart. I'm randomizing 21 bits of mmap calls and 21 bits of the exec base. That's pi. The exec len is for pi. So when I run this application, you'll see that address gets randomized each time. So sudo sysctl security.pax.aslr.status equals 0. So I've got ASLR turned off globally, and that address isn't randomized anymore. So right now what I'm doing is I'm adding a UJITFW, a firewall or file system firewall rule to disable ASLR for that one application. Actually, what I'm going to do, CP test. I'm going to disable ASLR just for that application. It's object file sys home Sean 10 test mode. This mode says I can read the file and execute it. PAX flags, the PAX flags option, which is optional. The lowercase a means ASLR is disabled for this application. The uppercase a means it's enabled. So if we're running an opt-in basis, using a capital A, we'll say I'm opting in this application to ASLR. So now you can see the behavior is the same, but security.pax.aslr.status. We can see that the ASLR is enabled, but it is disabled for that application. So if I copied test to test you, so it's a different file, we can see that ASLR is still working, but for other files.
Can you run it just with sudo, just so we can see the firewall?
The firewall rule?
Yeah.
It is...
Oh, no, just run test this.
Oh, yes.
A different user.
Yep. So... running it as a different user means ASLR is applied for that file. I chose 10 because it's a nice, easy number to remember. So now that I removed the firewall rule, ASLR is enabled. So that's really it for the presentation. I wanted to thank a few people. Oliver Pinter is the one who initially started development on the ASLR feature. What happened was I had posted on my little tech blog that I was going to start working on ASLR for FreeBSD, and then he somehow saw that post and then contacted me and said, hey, let's work together. So I added the per jail support, Pi support, and the UJITFW stuff, and he did quite a few other awesome things. Danilo Egea, he's working on the SAG vGuard feature. And Ryan Steinmetz is the ports committer and ports sec team member that I work with. He's awesome. I'm probably going to murder this name, Johannes Meixner. No clue how to say that last name. He convinced me to send a status report for the quarterly status report, which got some people interested in and added some more testers to CFTQ. And to Soldier X for donating hardware. and support otherwise. So these slides are online. It's just a text file that you can open up with Vim, Emacs, whatever. So you can. These are some references. And thank you very much for coming.